And then when the movie was being cut together, Alan really wanted to cut. He thought it was a downer, the song and whatever. Maybe everybody else thinks it's a downer too. I certainly don't. But, you know, it was so much about what that character was. And it got in there by the skin of its teeth. And Pat Birch fought for it, and I think Bronte, and I don't know, and I think the director as well. I mean, but it's in there, and I'm so grateful that it is.
It's one of the best moments in the show and the film. They look right. I never knew they were considering cutting that song.
Oh, they hated it. Alan said, "Oh, this is such a bummer." I was down. He's gonna be all happy and, you know, whatever. And it was a long shoot, but it was incredibly technically beautifully well done. It's beautifully shot. It's beautifully produced. You just couldn't do that again. I mean, the talent putting that thing together, the costumes and this, it was Pat. It looks like it's all a little bubblegum kind of thing. It's not. It was a massive endeavor, and Paramount was way behind it. It was great. We got lousy reviews, and look at it now.
Yeah.
Hello, my loves. Welcome back to my YouTube channel, or welcome to my YouTube channel if you're new. I'm Scarlett Siren. You can call me Scarlett. I hope you guys are doing great on this amazingly sunny Sunday. Wow, that's kind of hard to say. that was fun. If it's not sunny where you are, I apologize, but I do hope you're still doing great. But look, there is sunlight. Can you believe it? I feel like I've not seen sunlight in so long. And let me tell you, it makes a huge difference. My mood is immediately better when there is sunlight. So, yeah, I'm excited about it. Who would have thought? Sunlight. Who knew? Turns out a lot of people, actually. there's even a whole thing about how sunlight affects your mood and yada, yada, yada. Anyway, I'm not a therapist. I'm not getting into it. Although, interestingly enough, I have been thinking about going back to school to become a therapist, and I have discussed it with my own therapist. So, yeah, I'm already getting off topic here. Anyway. I told you guys last week that this would be a little bit more of a nostalgia review for this week, and it kind of is. It's not really a nostalgia review. Like, I'm not reviewing it to see if it holds up. I'm doing it to see if my perspective on the song will have changed over time. If you saw the clip that I included in the beginning, then chances are you probably already know what song this is. And really, honestly, let's be real here, you already know what song it is anyway, because it's in the damn title of the video. Like, come on, Scarlett. Use your brain. Sometimes I amaze myself with how dumb I really am. Yeah, anyway. You all already know what song this is because you read the title. You're not stupid. Unlike me, who, you know, let's face it, I do really stupid stuff. Anyway, this is one of my, let me put it this way. Grease was one of my favorite movies when I was in like the sixth or seventh grade. That was around the first time I saw it. And after I saw that movie, I don't even remember how I originally saw it. I may have caught it on TV or something. I don't remember. That's probably what happened. I think it was. And I caught it on TV, and my mom was a fan of it, and I immediately went through like a huge obsession with Olivia Newton-John, and oh my god, it was so, that movie became my personality for a while. I wanted to be Olivia Newton-John for a very long time. But as I've gotten older, and you know, changed as a person, you know, looking back on it, and I have not seen that movie in over 20 years. I need to rewatch it. I haven't seen it in so long. It's been a very long time. But as I've gotten older and, you know, kind of look back on it without actually watching it, you know, I've seen the odd clip here and there. I've come to realize that being Sandy is not, that's not who I grew up to be. Let's be honest. I did not grow up to be Sandy. I grew up to be Rizzo. If we're just gonna be straight up honest, I grew up to be Rizzo, and I hit that point in my late teens. Yeah, the sarcasm, the pretending to be, more badass than you actually are. Yeah, I grew up to be Rizzo. So I wanted to look back on Rizzo's solo number from Greece, because number one, I adore Stockard Channing. Typically, when people think of Stockard Channing, Greece is what they think of. For me, the very first thing that I saw her in was Practical Magic. And so I grew up knowing her as Aunt Frances from Practical Magic. And again, that character shaped my personality. I feel like most characters that Stockard Channing portrayed shaped my personality. I grew up to be a very sarcastic and dry individual, and I credit Stockard Channing for a lot of that. Yeah, there's just no getting around it. But anyway, my point was I wanted to go back and look at this because back when I originally watched Grease, I didn't really pay that much attention to Rizzo's number. Like, I liked it. I didn't dislike it. I didn't actively skip it when I would watch the movie, like I did with, say, like Beauty School Dropout. I've never really liked that song. I still probably wouldn't care for that one if I were to listen to it now. So I would always skip that part of the movie. But I never actually skipped Rizzo's song, but I didn't actively seek it out either because I was more focused on Olivia Newton-John, who I absolutely loved and still love to this day. May she rest in peace. But I wanted to re-examine this song to see if my feelings about it have changed because who I am as a person has changed since the last time I heard this song, and I have more of a appreciation for Betty Rizzo than I did when I originally watched this. So I wanted to re-examine that. So it's not a does this hold up? It's a have my thoughts on it changed. So we're gonna get into this. And yeah, let's just see. Am I still as indifferent to it now as I was as a kid? Probably not, but we'll see. Hopefully, we don't have any technical issues like we did the last time with my cursor. That was entertaining. I still have no idea what happened there. So I apologize for that. But let's get into this. I am really excited. Like I said, I've not heard this song in 20 years. I remember bits and pieces of it. I remember it being kind of jazzy. And I love jazz music, so I'm really excited to see if it's still, as jazzy as I remember, or if not. So let's get into this. I don't know if I hit the right button. I can't see my screen. I did not. Okay, oops. I was like, why am I not hearing anything? Because I'm an idiot and hit the wrong button. I'm sorry.
There are worse things I could do than go with a boy or two.
She's not wrong.
Even though the neighborhood thinks I'm trashy and no good, I suppose it could be true.
Oh.
But there are worse things I could do.
I mean, yeah.
I could flirt with all the guys.
There's that jazziness. There it is. Yep.
Smile at them and bat my eyes. Press against them when we dance. Let them think they stand a chance. Then refuse to see it through. That's the thing I never do.
Hey, she's got
I could
standards.
stay home every night.
God, her voice.
Wait around.
never caught that as a kid. I'm sorry. Oh my God. I'm sorry. I never got what that meant as a kid, and now as an adult, I get it. Oh, sorry. I get it now. I never realized what that line meant as a kid. The take cold showers. I get it now. I know what she's talking about. Sorry. Anyway, I also wanted to pause to examine something. I think a lot of this, sorry, I'm still hung up on that. I think the lyrics also you have to kind of keep in mind that when you're listening to them and thinking about it, you have to remember this was set in a different time period. So, you know, like being close to someone when you dance, you know, that kind of things like that. Now we would be like, what's the big deal? I mean, I said it earlier. What's wrong with that? But you have to also consider that at that time, that was something that good girls didn't do. And that's kind of what Rizzo is saying. You know, she's admitting, you know, that, hey, I'm not Little Miss Goody Two-Shoes, and, you know, people say I'm trashy. And Rizzo was not trashy. Rizzo just wasn't, she just wasn't what people considered ladylike. And, you know, that's changed. Now we're like, dude, Rizzo's a badass. You know, she was the real one, and we love her for it. But back then, that was frowned upon, and so it's different. And you kind of have to remember that, you know, and I'm having to remind myself of that as I'm listening to it. You know, things were just different back then. You know, good girls didn't do that kind of thing. So it's interesting. Okay, I'm going to get back to it. Please ignore my, my utter amusement with that line. I'm sorry. It never clicked until just, I'm sorry. Here we go. And again, I hit the wrong button. Dang it.
I could hurt someone like me.
I love a good saxophone.
Out of spite or jealousy. I don't steal.
I like it more now.
Do.
The voice. God, it's just beautiful. Okay, I'm just going to say it. Stockard Channing could have had an amazing career as a jazz singer if she had wanted to. Her interpretation of the material is just so... It is the perfect example of an actor who sings versus a singer who acts, which is what I would classify someone like Olivia Newton-John. She was a singer who also occasionally acted. Stockard is, you know, the complete opposite. She is an actor who occasionally sings. And that is key, I think, in putting it real emotion into a song, because you have that capability. For instance, the film version of Les Mis that came out with Russell Crowe, Anne Hathaway, I have heard so many renditions of I Dreamed a Dream by so many different people, so many different actors, so many different singers, you know, you name it. And one of my all-time favorite singers in the world is Haley Westenra, and she recorded a version of I Dreamed a Dream on one of her albums. She's also sang it live many times, but it never really made me feel anything, because yes, her vocals are flawless and perfect and crystal clear and they're beautiful, but she is simply singing the notes. There's no real emotion behind it. And that's okay for a lot of songs, but with a song like that, where the lyrics are so important and there is such a history behind it and the emotion, you just really need it to be there. So I don't really actively seek out that version of that song, whereas Anne Hathaway is another actor who occasionally sings. And when she sang that song in that movie, there was emotion behind it. It made me cry. That you felt her pain. And that is something that I think that's good when you have actors that can sing. Now, that's not to say that some singers aren't incredible actors. Cher is a very good actor. Reba McEntire is a very good actor. But when you have someone that has made acting their livelihood, and they are also blessed with a wonderful singing voice, you know, you'd be a fool not to take advantage of it. And I think that's what makes Stockard such a fantastic, that's what makes this song so incredible, is the emotion behind it, because the emphasis that she puts on certain words, when she says, you know, I don't lie, you know, I don't steal, I don't lie, but I can feel. And the emphasis on feel is what makes that line so heartbreaking. And, you know, nobody in their right mind was believing that Stockard Channing was a teenager in Greece. Nobody. Unless you were a kid, you know, and when you saw it. But nobody over the age of, like, 12 or 13 was buying that. Like, come on. And don't get me wrong, Stockard is an amazingly beautiful woman. But she looked 33. And there's nothing wrong with that. You know, there's nothing wrong with, I don't look like a teenager. I'm not gonna go out and try to play one, you know, in a movie or anything. Or if I did, you know, they better use a lot of makeup to make that happen. But, you know, it was believable because of the, you know, the emotion that she put into it. And, you know, I've watched multiple interviews with her about this performance, and the clip that I showed in the beginning is a prime example of that. But coming from someone with a theater background like myself, we actually did a production of Grease, you know, in my hometown, and I've been in it, seen it, you know, multiple times over the years. And you really have to tap into that inner, you know, because Rizzo's the type of character that she puts on a brave front, but underneath it, you know, she's just a scared, vulnerable kid who is in a, you know, I'm gonna say probably that her home life is not great. So she has to act like she doesn't care. But, you know, deep down she really does. And that's the entire point of the song. You know, she can feel, she can cry, you know, something that, you know, whoever she's singing the song to, which I believe it's Kinnicky, he is in the scene, even though she's not singing directly to him. She's kind of relating to him. You know, she's basically saying, you know, I care about you, but I bet you probably don't even know that I can cry because I've never cried in front of you. And to me, allowing that moment of weakness I mean, it's not weakness, but what she perceives as weakness to come through and cry in front of him, you know, to her, that is the ultimate worst thing that she could ever do. And that's kind of heartbreaking when you really stop to think about it. Because, and I was like that when I was, you know, in high school, and I'm still kind of like that. I don't like crying in front of people. And unfortunately, I'm one of those people that cry when I get mad. It's nothing worse than trying to prove a point when you're mad and you're crying and you just look, it's terrible. And so a lot of, especially younger people are like that, especially, you know, when you're a teenager, you don't want people to see you as, you know, weak or soft or whatever, however you want to word it. Even though, you know, being in touch with your emotions is a good thing, but, you know, God forbid someone in your high school see that. You know, bullies are relentless, they're ruthless. And I think that Stockard did a great job in capturing that emotion and letting that inner vulnerability kind of shine through in that song. And so, yeah, I like that song a lot more, especially now as an adult, re-examining it. I definitely relate to Rizzo a lot more than I relate to Sandy. Like, I'm just gonna say it. Sandy is the type of girl that we all wanted to be because she was, you know, pretty and popular, and but she wasn't bitchy. Like, she wasn't snobby. She wasn't rude. She was just a very sweet, genuine person. And she didn't want to hurt anyone. And she was just trying to make friends and fit in. And that's kind of, we all have a little bit of Sandy in us, but very few people grow up to be Sandy. And I think that we, you know, especially me, you know, I think even in high school, I started to realize, you know, I'm never going to be that person. That's just not who I am. And, you know, like, I used to get in trouble all the time as a teenager in just my house for saying a lot of things that I probably shouldn't have. My attitude got me in trouble a lot. you know, I was very, I still am, very sarcastic, very dry. And I remember my grandmother used to tell me, you know, why are you always so hateful when you talk to people? And I was like, I'm not. I just, a lot of times I didn't realize the tone that I would say things in. And I remember one time my little cousin, she's not little anymore, but she was then, we were doing something at my grandparents' house. We spent summers there, and basically every weekend we were at my grandparents' house. But we were doing something, playing a game, watching TV, something. I don't remember what we were doing, but I looked at my little cousin and she started to cry. And sorry, my allergies are killing me. My nose is itching. My eyes have been watering like crazy. But she started to cry, and my grandmother was like, what did you do to her? You know, of course, you know, grandma runs in. She's like, oh no, what's wrong? What did you do? Because I was the oldest of the granddaughters. And she was like, what did you do? And I looked at her and I was like, I didn't do anything. I just looked at her. You know, I was just looking at her, and she started to cry. And my grandma was like, well, don't do that. Look at her. Okay. Like, to this day, I still don't know why she started to cry. I should ask her. I should text her and be like, hey, do you remember that? She probably doesn't. But if she does, be like, hey, why did you cry when I looked at you? Now, I will admit, one time I did accidentally almost blind my cousin. I didn't mean to. It had been raining, and we were outside playing, and we had an umbrella, and I accidentally hit her in the eye with the end of an umbrella. Oh my God, I felt so terrible for that. I mean, and it could have had disastrous results. I mean, it was a complete accident, and I felt so bad. And I just when I, you know, when she started freaking out, I started crying. I was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. And I mean, she was okay, but I felt so terrible. And I was like, you know, that makes sense to cry, but why did you cry when I looked at you? Like, I don't know. Although I have had a lot of people tell me that I have resting bitch face. And, you know, I get it from my mother. She has it too. And yet people still come up and talk to me randomly in public. Why do you do that? Don't do that. Don't do that. I'm kidding. If anybody ever sees me out in public and they want to say hi, feel free. I don't care. I mean, nobody's ever going to do that. Nobody's ever going to run into me. I'm not famous by any means. You know, no one's ever going to follow me around. And I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for that. But my point was, when I got to high school, I kind of realized, yeah, I don't do a lot to get in trouble because I was terrified of getting in trouble. Like I was terrified of my dad growing up because he would just look at you and you would immediately like fear. It was horrible. And he's still like that. That's why I don't deal well with people raising their voices. Even if they're not yelling at me, if someone raises their voice, I automatically start to shake and there's nothing I can do to stop it. So I was always terrified of doing anything to get in trouble, you know, anything that would make my parents mad at me. So I didn't do anything rebellious in that sense. Like I was the drama nerd. I was the band geek. I was the choir girl, you know, I did all those things. But, you know, personality wise, I was definitely, you know, I was Rizzo. Still am. Like my favorite line in the entire movie has always been, even from the very first time I saw it, was when Marty asks if Rizzo likes her new glasses, because she asks, don't you think they make me look smarter? And Rizzo, without missing a beat, says, no, you can still see your face. That has always been my favorite line. It will always be my favorite line. Rizzo is my spirit animal. And I really need to go back and watch that movie again. I have not watched it in forever. And this time around, I'm going to be watching Stockard. Before, it was always, where's Olivia? You know, I want to watch Olivia. Now, I'm going to be like, where is my girl Stockard? Like, I'm going to be watching her in every scene. Even if she's just in the background, I'm going to be like, what's she doing? Because Stockard is also one of those amazing background actors where even if the camera is not on her, if you watch her in the background, you can see her doing something that is always brilliant. And I think if I could be like any actor from that time period, it would be Stockard Channing. She has had an amazing, illustrious career. She's a master at subtle acting. There are a few scenes that I've seen in The West Wing where her expression will not change. But if you watch, there's something subtle. Like there's a scene where Martin Sheen tells her that he didn't see something. And he's like, I didn't see it. You know, I couldn't see it out of that eyes. I didn't see it. And outwardly, she's calm. She's like, okay. And she doesn't, her expression never changes. But if you watch her very closely, her breathing changes. And it goes from calm, you know, everyday, normal, automatic breathing. It speeds up the way that your breathing would if you were fighting panic and fear. And something is going on outside my house and I don't know what it is. It's very loud. Anyway, it changes and it's so subtle and it's not something that you would notice on like a first watch. It's something that you would really only pick up on if you've seen it multiple times, and you are specifically looking at her. And the first time I watched that scene, I didn't notice it because I was watching Martin, who I absolutely adore, as we all know. Yeah, I love Martin Sheen. Anyway, but the second time I watched it, I was like, okay, first time, watch Martin. Second time, watch Stockard. Because I always like to do that. If I enjoy something, I like to go back and watch things to kind of pick up on things that I might have missed the first time around. And that, you know, I've done that with things as long as I can remember. And so I always like to watch other actors in, like, if the focus is not on them, I like to watch to see how they respond to the focus actor. I don't know how to describe a focus act. So, okay, if the camera's on, okay, let's say camera's on Martin. I'm gonna focus on Stockard to see how she is reacting to what Martin is doing, and vice versa. If the camera is on Stockard, I'm going to be watching Martin to see how he is reacting to Stockard's performance. I've always been interested in that. Like, the non-focal point, I like watching their reaction. You can learn a lot about characters based on that. If they're not the focal point, but you watch them anyway, because chances are the director has told them, you're not the focus here, but do not break character. Because breaking character is one of the worst things you can do. I know, I've done it. that happened to me on opening night of one of the plays that I was in, one of the musicals I did in high school. Opening night, I forgot one of my lines. Like, I didn't forget what the line was. I missed the cue. It was the beginning of a song and I missed the cue because I couldn't hear the orchestra. And so I missed it. And I was like, oh no, oh no, oh my God, what are we doing? It's opening night, we're screwed. And so I tried so hard not to break character. And I managed to save it. I picked it up, got it done. And as soon as I went backstage, I took off my microphone and busted out laughing. Like, I made sure that I was not close enough to the stage or my microphone to hear, you know, so that nobody could hear it. But I just could not stop laughing. And this was a, like, our stage, our theater department, we did not always have enough equipment for everybody. So we would have to, only certain characters would have a microphone at all times. All of, like, the secondary characters, if you weren't on stage at that point, you would give your microphone to someone else because we didn't have enough microphones for everybody. So we were always, you know, trading mics here and there, you know, and their small town theaters are fun. They really are. And there was one point, my character had a crutch that I had to use. And in one part of the play, my character's father took the crutch and laid it down on a grave. And it was my character's grave. But it was a fantasy sequence. So I wasn't really dead. It was just a flash forward of the future. And so he took the crutch and laid it on the grave. And then the very next scene I was in, you know, so I had to have that crutch. And it never failed that half the time during rehearsal, he would forget, the actor that played my father would forget to grab the crutch and bring it backstage so that I could have it. And that actually happened in one of our first performances, the opening weekend. It wasn't opening night. I think it was the second night that we did it. And so I'm standing backstage and I'm like, hello, like, I can't go out. Like, my character cannot walk without this crutch and I don't have it. It's on the other side of the stage. I was like, what are we gonna do? And so we were scrambling, we were trying to figure it out. And I was like, okay, let me just lean on someone. Like, let me have an actor, just let's try that and see if it works. And it worked. Luckily, I don't think anybody thought too much of it. And then it got to the point during performances that I would stand in the wings and wait for that fantasy sequence to end. And then as soon as the lights would come back up, I would stand where the actor that played my father could see me and be like, hey, bring the crutch back. Eventually he got to the point where he would remember. But it was so much fun. And I really, that's what I love about doing musical theater, because you have actors that can sing, and that is what makes it work. That's why I am not a fan typically of stunt casting, where you take a well-known singer and put them in a role just for name recognition. Now, sometimes it works. Like Josh Groban just finished doing Sweeney Todd. And he got his start in musical theater as well. So in that sense, it works because he has that background. Now, I don't know. I'm guessing that she does really well with this, or they wouldn't have continued to do this. But the singer JoJo played in Moulin Rouge recently, and I think she may actually have a theater background. So in that case, it would work as well. And she's an amazing vocalist anyway. But as a general rule, I am not really a fan of stunt casting. I would say Ariana Grande is an example of this, but she also has a theater background as well, so it doesn't really apply. But she's not really known for her acting performances. So I'm cautiously optimistic with the film version of Wicked. I'm very, very cautiously optimistic. I know that she is a big fan of Kristen Chenoweth, who originated the role, and I know Kristen has said that she is excited about it. So I'm hoping that it'll do really well. I don't know. I've never seen Ariana do a stage production, so I don't know how extensive her background is, but I do know she has a theater background. So I am cautiously optimistic that she'll do fine. I'm just worried if it's going to be difficult for her to kind of shed that pop star vocalist thing that she has going on, because there's a very big difference between like Broadway vocals and pop vocals. Huge difference. So I'm wondering how that's gonna work, which is why, I think to get back on track here with this, with Stockard, I think that this worked very well because she is an actor that can sing. So she is used to putting emotion and depth into these performances. And that's what she does with her vocals. And she did a performance in a musical a while back. God, it's been almost 20 years already. And she kept trying to tell them, I can sing. I can project. I can make my vocals loud and big and, project. And I can do this. And they were like, but we don't want you to do that. We want you to do it subtle and subdued, and we don't want a big theater type performance here. And she said, that she did it that way, because they asked her to. And she said, that her voice would crack occasionally. And I've always really kind of liked when vocalists, when they're, I love when singers are not afraid. And I've said this before, I said it when I did the Sinead O'Connor reaction. I love when singers are not afraid to sound less than perfect. I love that. And it's something that I struggle with. That's why a lot of times I will have like a drink or two before I go into the recording studio to kind of just let go. Because if I don't, I am so worried about, did I hit the note absolutely perfectly? And then there's no emotion behind it, which again, you know, that if the music doesn't make you feel anything, why even make it? Why even listen to it? So that's why I love it when they're, now if it's just because the artist is having a, like if they're sick or something like that, then I don't enjoy it because I know that it's not, you know, I know that it's not emotion. It's just they do not feel well, and I would rather that they felt like they could just take the time to rest. And but if it's just a purely emotional vocal crack or vocal fry or something like that, I love those. Those are amazing to me. And that's what I loved about this performance was Stockard is not a singer. I mean, she is, but that is not her primary job. She is an actor who just happens to occasionally sing. And I think that that makes all the difference. And it really shows in this performance. And it was so much better than I remembered, because I actually took the time to give the song the respect it deserves and listen to it. And that's why I try not, I know a lot, I've said this before, I know a lot of people may not like my reaction channel because I don't say a lot during the song that I'm listening to. But that's because I want to listen to it and I want to give it the attention and respect that it deserves. So, I have sufficiently rambled for 41 minutes, and yeah, I think you guys have probably had enough of me today, but I do want to say before I cut this short, well, not really short, it's a little late for that, before I end this, I want to say how much I love you guys. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your suggestions. Please keep them coming. I have a lot going on with my schedule right now. But I will get to everything, and enjoy the weather. It's supposed to be, at least where I am, it is supposed to be nice for the next week. So if you're like me and you've been missing the sun, get out there and enjoy it. I am not going to be able to enjoy much of it because I'm going to be at work, but I will enjoy it from my desk as I sit there and watch the traffic go by and wish that I could be on the outside. Enjoying life. I was not meant to have a regular job. I was meant to live in the woods as a swamp witch. I missed my calling. I really did. My goal in life is to grow up to be Aunt Frances from Practical Magic, so you know, I'm working towards that goal every day. I want to make midnight margaritas and dance around my kitchen. I don't even like margaritas, but I will make an exception. I'll make something at midnight and it'll be delicious. But anyway, I hope you guys have a great week. Enjoy the weather. I hope you enjoyed this reaction. And if you didn't, you know, that's fine. You don't have to. You don't have to come back. You can skip it. I won't be offended. As always, be kind to yourselves. Be kind to each other. If you have laundry in your dryer, fold it up. Always got to give you some kind of realistic advice at the end. But yeah, I love you guys, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!